Good morning, students. Yesterday, I explained you the poem Dust or Snow by Robert Frost. I hope all of you have gone through the poem properly. Okay, so now today we are going to talk about the various poetic devices which are used in this poem. So please listen carefully. All right, so the poem is Dust or Snow by Robert Frost. And today we are going to talk about the various poetic devices. So I'll just introduce you to the poetic devices first. Now, first is enjambment. I'm sure you've heard of it for the first time, but I'll be explaining you properly. Then we have symbolism. The next poetic device is imagery. Then after that, we have alliteration, metaphor. Then this is synecdoche. And assonance. Okay, most of them are very new to you, but I'll be explaining to you all properly. Now let's take the first poetic device, that is enjambment. Now what does this mean? First of all, just let's understand the meaning. Lines running from one to the next without punctuation marks. Full stops come only at the end. Now when we look at the poem, what do you notice? Look at the first stanza. Just look at the first stanza. The way a crow shook down on me, dust of snow from a hemlock tree. Now, in this stanza, we notice that there is no comma. Nothing. There's only a full stop, and that full stop is after the entire stanza gets over. And it is one sentence. The entire stanza is written in one sentence. Like, see, the way a crow shook down on me, the dust of snow from a hemlock tree. So this is called enjambment. Okay, again, I explain that there are no commas, no punctuation marks. There's just a full stop after the stanza ends. So this is an enjambment. Now let's come to the next poetic device, that is symbolism. Now we've seen in the poem that there are three main symbols that are used. That is crow, hemlock tree and snow. Now when we talk about the literal meaning, literally what are these three symbols associated with? They are associated with sorrow. I had already explained you, when we talk about a crow, it's all the negative thoughts that come into our mind, because a crow is inauspicious. Then it is also it brings bad luck. It's bad omen. Then when we talk about a hemlock tree is also poisonous tree. Okay, with the white flowers. And normally poets, they do not write poetry on a crow or a hemlock tree because they are inauspicious. Then the snow also. The snow, when we talk about snow, it leads to hardships, because in winters are very harsh and there are very harsh conditions in winter. So these are the literal, what do these mean? But here, these particular three negative aspects, they have a very positive, they help in bringing a positive change, and they bring about a positive change in the mood of the poet. So these negative things in nature, they prove to have a very positive aspect on the poet's mood, and changes his mood absolutely. So this is what symbolism means. Opposite of the literal meaning of the objects that are mentioned in the poem. So that is called symbolism. Now the next poetic device that we are going to study is imagery. Now what do you mean by imagery? Imagery means any visual image that forms in your mind when you're reading. Okay, visual image of the forest. Now what comes into your mind when you're listening to the poem? Okay, you can visualize the forest. You can visualize the the tree, the hemlock tree covered with snow. Okay, the crow perched on the tree and shaking, making some movement on the tree, and the snowflakes falling on the traveler or on the poet who's standing lonely or is passing by through that hemlock tree. So this is an image that forms in your mind when you are reading the poem. So this is called imagery. So again, I just read: visual image of the forest with snow-covered trees, crow perched on the hemlock tree, lonely traveler passing by. So these are the images which are formed in our mind when we are reading the poems. That's called imagery. Now we come to the next poetic device, and that is alliteration. Now, we've already studied about alliteration before. So when we talk about alliteration, it is repetition of a letter in the sentence. Now here, has given my heart. Now here, has, H, and H in heart is repeated. Okay, so this is an alliteration. Now the next line is, and saved some part. Now again, S and S is repeated. So this is alliteration. This I'm sure all of you are already familiar with. Now we come to the next poetic device, that is metaphor. Now what did I tell you? I had explained you metaphor earlier. I'm sure you are aware of metaphor. Now simile is a direct comparison of two distinctly different objects, and metaphor is an indirect comparison. Now the dust of snow, now here the dust here, what are we referring to dust as a snowflakes? So comparison of snowflakes to dust. Indirect comparison of snowflakes is made to dust, and that is why it is a metaphor. It is an indirect comparison. So the snowflakes are compared to what? To dust. So distinctly different objects they are, and it is indirectly compared. There's no like or as in it. So this is metaphor. Now we come to the next one. That is the sixth one. This is a very new poetic device, which I'm sure you must have not heard of even. So this is synecdoche. This is another poetic device. That is synecdoche. Now in this, a part of something represents the whole, or it may use a whole to represent a part. Okay. Now again, I'll just explain this to you properly. Now suppose we use the sentence, has Mike got wheels? Now wheels refers to only a part of a vehicle. But here in the sentence, by wheels, we mean whether he's got a car or a bike or any vehicle has he bought it. So here wheels, though it's a part, but is referring to a whole. Whole means to a car or any other vehicle that he has bought. Now similarly, India beat England at cricket. Now India, here we are referring to India as a whole and England as a whole. But it is not that the entire India has beaten the entire England. It is the Indian team that has beaten the England team at cricket. So this is the whole that is referring to a part. Now we come to the poem. Now how is synecdoche used in the poem? Now let's get back to the poem. Now here, has given my heart a change of mood. Now here the poet has used heart here. So it is not only the heart that had undergone a change, but his entire self as a person, he had undergone a change. So here heart is referring to only a part of his body. But it was not only his heart, but his entire being that underwent a change. So this is synecdoche. Okay, now we come to the last one, that is assonance. Now here, what do you mean by assonance? Now you just see the sentence. When any vowel is repeated in the sentence, in the entire line, there's a repetition of a vowel, that is assonance. Like shook down on me. Now you see the vowels. Shook, double O, down, again O, and on here, O. And here also E. So shook down on me. So now can you see this repetition of O in the sentence? So this is called the vowel repeated in the line. That is called assonance. So these are the various poetic devices which are used in this poem, that is Dust of Snow. So quick, okay, now we even talk about, let's even discuss the rhyme scheme. What is the rhyme scheme of this poem? Now let's get back to the poem again. Now, the way a crow shook down on me the dust of snow from a hemlock tree. Now, see now, crow, now look at the last words in the lines. Crow, me, snow, tree. Now, what do we notice? Crow and snow are rhyming. So, we will write A here and A here. Okay, now, me and tree are rhyming. So, that becomes B and B. Now, let's see the next stanza. Has given my heart a change of mood and saved some part of a day I had rued. Now see, heart, again, it is rhyming with part. So this becomes AA. And mood and rude are rhyming. So that becomes BB. So what is the rhyme scheme here? AB, AB. Second stanza, also it is AB, AB. So that's the poem that I've explained you. So once again, quick revision. The poet is in a melancholic, sad, gloomy mood. He's passing by a hemlock tree. And while passing, a crow just happens to make some movement on the tree. And that movement causes the snowflakes to fall on the poet. And as soon as the snowflakes fall on the poet, it brings about a sudden change in his mood. His melancholic mood, gloomy, depressed mood suddenly changes. Okay, and that incident of a very small incident of the snowflakes falling on him brings about a major change in his mood and saves his day from being ruined in regret. So half of his day had already passed in brooding over what had happened, the incidents that had happened that particular day. He was not happy with what had happened. So that small little incident that happened with him that changed his entire mood and that filled him with positivity, and he left the tree with a very happy and a positive mood. And maybe this entire incident may have given him, you know, idea for his next poem. So that is why he's written this poem, Dust of Snow, because this brought about a massive change in his mood. So I hope this poem is clear to all of you. Now I would request all of you to go on your Extra Marks app, revise the poem again on it. You have the Diksha map also, app also. Then go through the, try to attempt the questions which are given there. Try to solve the exercises that are given related to this poem. And I'll be circulating you the notes of these poems. So just be a little regular with your work. That's it. Thank you.